I'm Coach Mike Chadwick, and you're listening to The Read On Revolution. This is an original audiobook published by WF Howes Limited. Introduction. Who I am. There is a strong argument to suggest that there is no growth in comfort. And right now, I'm uncomfortable. Coaching, training, and getting the most out of people is nothing new to me. Getting it down in a book format is. As is sitting in an audiobook recording booth, talking into a microphone and recording it out loud. I am just like you. I want to grow. I want to get better, and I'm willing to do whatever it takes. So let me start by asking you, how great can you be? Before you answer, let me tell you where my comfort zone does lie. It's in making you a better and stronger version of who you are today. It's finding a way to win and helping you unlock your potential and greatness, whatever that looks like. Hopefully, that is why you found this audiobook. And hopefully, you can already see that by doing something new in order to improve myself, I'm practicing what I preach. So who am I? And why should you listen to what I say? My name is Coach Mike Chadwick. My background is in a 13-year career in the British Army, as a member of the Parachute Regiment, Special Forces Support Group, and as a Royal Army Physical Training Corps instructor, across which I received multiple commendations and awards, culminating in being given the Breddon Trophy, handed to the soldier who has contributed most to enhance the prestige of physical development within the British Army. When I tore up the British Armed Forces' century-old approach to physical development, I was credited with revolutionising soldier training in the citations, and after delivering unprecedented pass rates across the Army, including the Parachute Regiment's infamous P Company, I have since turned my attentions elsewhere, to improving performance in other areas of physical development and competition globally. This includes international special forces, including the UK, being the strength and conditioning coach for people to pass what is arguably the most arduous selection course in the world, and to tactical professionals worldwide, including firefighters, police, first responders, private security officers and anti-poachers, and to athletes, training and bringing success to UFC fighters, marathon runners, powerlifters and GB rowers, as well as presenting to professional and international football teams from the Premier League to Gareth Southgate's England team. I have founded my own companies whilst doing so. My businesses, Red On Fitness and Red On Socks, and my fitness app, the Red On Challenge. This audiobook is called The Red On Revolution. It's therefore already clear that the term Red On is central to my message. And as we go through, you'll understand why. Today, much of my work has been done from the shadows, in essence, as the secret coach. A lot of me is built on secrecy, until now. Welcome to the Red On Revolution. This is my audiobook. It contains my message to the best of my ability. It's taken sacrifice through effort, planning, commitment, and a lot of time. It will go against the grain and probably put the back up of people who don't want to see me do well. But I love that. Spectators can't get upset with the results they don't get from the work they didn't do. I want this book to show you that our job is to do the impossible. The bystander's job is to either believe we can't or to stop us. That's the balance of competition. We think it's possible and prove everyone wrong. Without everyone else thinking we can't do something, there is no contest and no point. When things are handed to us, it loses its worth. I set out with a goal that required me to work on my weaknesses as well as harness my strengths, and I've stuck with it. I stayed the course, which is exactly what you'll need to do to succeed. I have realised over the years that it's okay if you don't know anything. What kills you is when you don't know anything, but you think you know something. My success comes not from what I know, but from how I deal with what I don't know. That said, the very fact you are listening to this in its finished form is also evidence that you too want to know more, and that my goal was achievable. If you're clear on what it is you want, and are happy to put in the work I just alluded to, you will achieve your goals too. This audiobook is here to help you do so, and so let me tell you just how it will go about doing that. Before I tell you what this book will do, maybe it's worth me being clear on what it won't do. It won't provide a quick fix to a problem, because the reason most people fail in the first place is because they give up what they want most for what they want now. So it's not going to piece together a generalized, one-size-fits-all training program for every single person who listens to it to all then go away and do. Even if you just listened to that sentence and your reaction was, shit, that is what I wanted. Believe me, it's not. It's not going to encourage you to train as hard as you possibly can in every single 3 minute that you have. Any preconceptions you may have about fitness, and especially fitness that comes from a military angle, get rid of them. This is not one of those audiobooks. If anything, it'll do the exact opposite. Indeed, I will cover things such as boot camps and thrashings, and terms such as overtraining and junk mileage, and I cannot wait to explain why these are going to work against you rather than for you. Equally, no matter how catchy the Coach Mike method would have been as a title, the contents of this audiobook do not constitute the latest fad regime, mass-produced for a quick buck, before becoming irrelevant and disproved in 6 months' time. Finally, although I will cover it, and will identify it as an undeniable part of your weaponry, especially as your aims get tougher and tougher, this audiobook will not concentrate on mental strength ahead of physical strength. Your mind can be the strongest in the world, but if your body is not up for it, you're not going to succeed. As I say, my lane is physical development, and when it comes down to it, it's the biggest lane of all. What this original audiobook will do is show you the optimal pathway to follow for any goal that involves a sustained physical and psychological effort. It will change how you view physical development and force you to question and reassess how you approach training and making real, sustainable changes in your life. It will myth bust and reframe. There are literally so many things that I'm going to show you how to think differently about. I won't detour by previewing them here, but trust me when I say you'll come across them from practically minute one. Rather than selling a snappy, flash-in-the-pan, get-fit-quick method, it will clearly present you with the fixed, oldest-time principles of physical growth. If you are an athlete with a high training age, i.e. you've been training at a good level for a long time, and you wish to further improve to hit a next-level target, it will provide you with the most efficient route to achieving that. If you are an athlete with a training age of zero, notice how I still refer to you as an athlete, even if you're a total novice, and you want to get fitter, stronger, and better than you were yesterday, the pathway I provide is every bit as relevant to you. Equally, although many of this audiobook's practical examples will be taken from the military, this is purely because my experience and expertise lay there. And so, although military-centric, such examples can be applied for anyone to grow from. If you're not interested in the military, it's not a deal-breaker. This is an audiobook about physical, psychological and psychosocial strength and development, which often cites military examples, rather than an audiobook about the military with some physical and mental tips thrown in. The same applies for the examples of athletes that I will draw on. Yes, I may work with the elites, who are at the very top of their game, but they follow the exact same principles that will apply to you in your training. I want to give you access to their secrets. Now let me tell you what this original audiobook will do. After this section is finished introducing you to who I am, we will begin a 5-part pathway that focuses on you and how we can develop you together. First, I will ask you to tell me who you are, as that's where our journey starts. Next, I will tell you what we need to even be able to begin our journey. And then, I will show you how we will go about getting to our endpoint. Fourthly, I will explain to you the science behind just why we do it that way. Lastly, to supplement your newfound physical knowledge, I will give you the psychological tools to make where we go from here an upward and sustainable process. And to cap it all off, in the form of an outro that bookends this introduction, I will pose just one final question. When do we stop? And I will see if by then you have learned that there is only one answer we should ever give to that particular question. Now, in addition to this pathway, each individual section will come with its own set of practical applications for you to then incorporate into your own arsenal. It's important to me that listeners to this are not left thinking, I've just listened to all of this, and although it makes sense and sounds compelling, I cannot apply it to my life. That is not what I want. I want you to be educated to go forward and help yourself, or, if in a position to do so, help others. One of the key aims when I started conceptualising the Read On Revolution is that I wanted to create what I call an army of experts. And so after each chapter, my optional tactical takeaways will strive to bridge that gap between education and application. Each individual chapter will also be complemented by its own accompanying special guest interview. In these, I have either looked to harvest additional insider knowledge from an elite performer so that our wisdom can be extended to your own training, or, in cases where the topic strays away from my lane, I have sought out expert support. As a result, I am proud to say that this audiobook includes contributions from UFC heavyweight fighter Tom Aspinall, reigning world strongest man Tom, and reigning Europe strongest man Luke, aka the Stoltman brothers, former Royal Marine and Special Boat Service operator Simon Jeffries, elite international CrossFit competitor and current holder of the title of the Army's Fittest Woman, Charlotte Spence, former SF operator and now TV star Ann Middleton, former airborne and commando trained and now nutrition and performance expert Dr. Ash Cox, former parachute regiment and now current Team GB Paralympian Scotty Mina, and ex-special forces operator turned entrepreneur Anthony Stazicker. From time to time, I will also take the chance to build for you a picture of who I am now and how I have gotten to where I am today. These intermission sections, as I call them, of which there are four in this audiobook, will go back through my professional life, counter-chronologically, across key defining periods, from my time at the Infantry Training Centre and Army Foundation College, all the way back to when I joined the military as a fresh-faced recruit in 2007. If you don't want military stories, then feel free to crack on and skip them. As I say, this audiobook is about what I can tell you, not what you can learn about me. However, they're not just there to talk about my life. Instead, they're my best attempt at showing you why I know firsthand that everything I am telling you works, and should give you an idea of who I am and what I've had to do to get to where I have. You'll realise that the twists and turns in my life and career were often out of my hands, but I utilised every defining moment to my advantage. Success does not happen by accident. It's hard work, perseverance, studying, analysing, sacrifice, and most importantly, loving what you do. Who I am recording this audiobook for. One of the biggest myths I want to bust is what I do and what I teach only applies to elite soldiers or athletes. Because the principles I preach and the practical applications that I prescribe are universal, not exclusive. It's for everyone. It's the methods and individualized pathways within these principles that change to suit you and only you. The end goal is what determines the traits needed, which in turn determines the pathway. Your ability will then determine the work in parts within and how long it will take you. This audiobook is for you, and I'll share everything I know. This leads me on to the last point of this introduction, which is, why am I telling you this? Firstly, I think there is a hell of a lot of bad information about physical training out there that needs addressing, and I think I'm as well placed as anyone to do that. I've got thousands of hours of studying and coaching, and I've genuinely seen it all. From the good, the bad, the stupid, and the dangerous, and I want to share it all with you. Secondly, everyone has something they are obsessed with. For me, it's coaching. I love nothing more than putting people who shouldn't be on that start line, on that start line. That's where my passion is. That alone forms a very large part of my why. Third, across the fitness industry, there has been a skew in recent years towards the importance of mental strength and fortitude. These kind of books are, more often than not, fantastic and deserve their success. But I want to add greater balance to what is out there in the market, to greater represent for the huge part of the performance pie chart that is physical ability. See this as a prequel or as a companion to, rather than competition with the psychological heavy, mindset focused books. To win, you must cover all bases. Therefore, my 5-part pathway is going to be mostly physical, but it's surrounded by psychological and psychosocial considerations to form the whole picture. The philosophies within can be applied to business, the battlefield, the pitch, and for everyone and anyone who wants to realise their true potential and be the very best version of themselves. And because any journey you take is always going to start at one place, it makes sense that we should now begin with finding your why. And to do that, I need to find out who you are. Chapter 1, Who You Are. To begin this, I firstly want to know who you are. This is quite a difficult thing for anyone to answer, and in fact takes quite a bit of internal searching. But it's extremely important for our journey to understand your start point. Without knowing who you are right now, it's very difficult to begin and get to where you want to be. To do so, and to help me to get to know you, I'll begin by asking three simple questions, which allow me to determine your start point, your barriers, and your commitment. Question 1. Tell me about your current training regime and what you want to achieve. I want to talk about you right now. What I don't want to hear is who you used to be. I find so often that the moment I start asking these questions to people in the context of training, most start by telling me about their previous training experience. They would explain that they could do X amount of sit-ups 10 years ago, or I had trials at Y in my youth. I ran a sub-3-hour marathon before I had my children. Now, understanding previous training experience can be beneficial, but that's not what I'm asking. I don't want a training history at this moment in time. I simply want to know about you now. How many sit-ups can you do right now? How fast can you run your marathon now you have had children? This is you today, and be ruthlessly honest in how you view yourself. If you are a long way from where you want to be, this may feel like it's being cruel, but it's being kind, as it's the most helpful thing you can do come the beginning, both for me and yourself. You see, I'm not going to be working with a version of you from another era, and therefore I do not care about anything prior to today. It's going to be about you right now and what you do from this starting point onward. And so I only want to know who you are at this point. If your answer is, I currently do absolutely nothing, then that is a true and current reflection, which is fine, and we'll change that. Reverting back to something you used to be is a trigger that most people do. It's to shy away from who they are now in an attempt to distance themselves from the current situation. Maybe it's embarrassment, pride, or maybe it's just mortification about how you have let a once high standard slip. But that doesn't matter. That negative emotion is no longer needed, because you're doing something about it now. It's vital you own this situation. Be honest with who you are and take pride that you are here to be better. So, what do you truly want? Hypothetically, if you had a clean slate, what is it that you would want to achieve? Imagine you don't have to worry about time, money, family issues and other external pressures. You have no obligations and zero responsibilities as everything is taken care of. Your life is just a blank slate for training. What would you want then? What is your goal and when do you want it by? Psychologically speaking, are you doing this for you? Is it for vanity or for performance? Intrinsic or extrinsic? Your aim is your own, and so therefore there is no right or wrong answer. It can be whatever you want it to be. The more personal to you, the better, as effort is often a direct reflection of interest. For instance, I was once training with an athlete and close friend of mine named Gary McNamara, whose goal was to break the world record for the fastest marathon time by someone dressed as an item of fast food. The aim sounds strange to most, but in reality, it's an incredible achievement. When you can run a sub-3-hour marathon dressed as a hot dog, only then can you deem the goal silly. If the bloke who went past him dressed as a carrot is reading this, then you can say what the fuck you want. Gary was a Royal Engineer before being selected to be a Royal Army Physical Training Corps instructor on the same Class 1 course as myself. The aim of his had zero to do with his ability to be a physical training instructor, but it was his nonetheless, and nobody could take that away from him. His aim was outrageous, but it was his, and he worked his absolute arse off to ensure he saw it through. Your aim can be as outrageous as you want it to be as well, as long as it's yours, and as long as you can get through these three questions. Establishing just what you want to achieve is a huge part of finding your why. Because if you are not clear on what you want, then I will not be any clearer on what you want. And therefore, not only are you not going to push yourself to get there, but I also won't have the best tools to help you along the way. The more I know and understand you, the more I can help to define your pathway for success. I want to get you realizing just how important that is. Being honest with yourself on where you are now and being clear on where you want to go. As I would mention to all my army recruits during their first day on PT, be proud of who you are, where you are, and what you aspire to be. Go big with your aim. Be bold in what you want, and be brave in attacking it. If you aren't nervous or have no fear of failure in that thought, then potentially the aim is too small and might not be worth your time and effort. Only when we find your why can we build systems and create habits to bridge the gap between you now and where you want to be. Tell me about your life, your responsibilities and commitments, and any factors present or upcoming that may be a barrier to you reaching your goal. Having understood your dreams and your perfect world scenario, it's time to tell me all about what is going to stop you. Is it your family? Your other hobbies? Your access to a gym or to exercise equipment? Your working hours? Your economic situation? All these factors have a common denominator: time. And with time being everyone's currency, it's these things that add together and make up your environment. Like all environments, yours will be fluid and it will inevitably change. I call this your battlefield, and we will use this term going forward. Everyone's battlefield is different and individually unusual. It could be physical, mental, or a mixture of both. What everybody's battlefields do have in common is that they all demand dedication, perseverance, and motivation to ensure the highest possible chance of success, however it looks and whatever it changes to. The changing environment and climate of the battlefield places both intense physical and psychological demands on you. Success on the battlefield demands the ability and willingness to fight and win decisively against anyone or anything, anytime and anywhere. This may sound very army-centric, but you can apply this to any walk of life where you want to be successful. Whether you're trying to be the number one car salesman in your showroom or the best goalkeeper at your football club, willingness is an enthusiastic acceptance to be better and fight your way to the top. Training for these environments is vital, and steps should not be skipped. From the desert to the boardroom, I want you to win at all costs. Now, for the majority of people, trying to be the best and winning everything is daunting and often not even considered. I want to take this moment to explain what I mean by winning. A win is to be successful or victorious. The dictionary doesn't stipulate any further, which means it's in anything. So if your aim is to lift your granddaughter up to put the star on the Christmas tree, then getting a personal best in strict press is a win. It doesn't mean you have completed your aim. It doesn't mean you have the world's heaviest strict press, but it means you are winning. And you will need a lot more wins en route to raising that little girl high up above your head to place that star on the tree. Aims are like this. And even when the most decorated athletes win the most medals in the best style, they shouldn't forget about all those little wins that led to those moments. Hundreds and thousands of small wins every day is what it takes to be successful. The fear of success is actually extremely common. So, if this is you, then you are not alone. The fear is when you have an ongoing anxiety of succeeding and winning, so much so that you can often be unintentionally self-sabotaging your ability. It's not even that you think you may fail or you're incapable of succeeding to a certain standard. It can often just be the fear of change that comes with success and whether you're up for it. Now, if this is you, then I want you to know that I genuinely believe in you. I believe that you are braver than what you think, smarter than what you let on, and stronger than you believe. And you, just like many before you, who too doubted themselves, can be a winner and you can be great. Whether you want to run your first mile without stopping, or become a Royal Marine Commando, you will have to accumulate loads of small wins consistently to make your dream a reality. But with the right framework and pathway, it is possible. Now, let's not kid ourselves. Winning can occasionally fall upon your lap through other people's lack of preparation, or you can get lucky and win something. But to do it repeatedly takes effort and takes time, yet it is achievable. This can't just happen by training physically, in the right way, at the right time, with the right amount of stimulus. You need to also surround yourself with like-minded people, as your battlefield does not only involve you. It is one thing being personally prepared and driven and able to work within your battlefield, but you need to ensure that everyone around, attached and dependent on you, psychosocially, are happy with you doing this. I'm confident you would have heard the term, you're only as strong as your weakest link. This applies here. So if you want to do this, you need to think about how you are going to make it work not only for you, but for the other people in your life. A great example of this in practice is people wanting to go on UK Special Forces selection. Now, this selection is regarded as the toughest in the world, and any external and negative influence would hugely degrade your already extremely low chance of success. Whenever somebody applies for my coaching to prepare them physically for it, I would always ask the question, are you sure your family are okay with it? During COVID lockdowns and restrictions, the isolation periods prior and the not being able to go home at all throughout would add strain to any relationship. Back to the original point. This would reduce your chances of passing a course that you already only have less than a 10% chance of passing anyway. Family aside, with aims this big, it's vital that if everyone isn't on board from the get-go and respects your goal, then you either cut them off or consider a new aim. You need to work with people around you and involve them in your thinking and planning early on. If anybody within your circle isn't working with you, then they are working against you. An awareness of your battlefield and your barriers is the perfect way to ask yourself whether you still want this and to force you to establish your priorities. You are never too busy to do something. You have just prioritized what was more important. You should be able to work around the barriers you have highlighted, regardless of your environment. If you are a smoker, then don't tell me you can't afford a gym membership. If you watch the football on the weekend, then don't tell me you don't have time to train. If your aim requires a lot from you physically, then your priorities must change to ensure developing physically is near the top, and small tweaks to your life, like how much TV you watch, or how many beers you have, are made to accommodate your aim. For those of you that have a newborn baby, you will understand that time is taken away from you very quickly. If you aren't a parent yet, then you'll realise how much spare time you actually did have if you do become one. Even as a parent, and even though you have time before and after work to train, the fact you are deep into sleep deprivation means you will prioritise sleep before it and therefore miss out on training. That's okay. Because you need to be fresh-ish for work to bring money home to feed the baby before repeating the cycle. That's life, and priorities are placed accordingly. It's probably therefore not the best time to announce to your partner and newborn child that you're going on UKSF selection, or you're going on stage to compete in a bodybuilding comp in 6 months. The nutrition alone will consume a lot of your life, never mind the hours and hours you will need to train. But if you say that, and do prioritise that huge aim above all, and everyone supports you for doing it, then your mindset and resolve and support team, combined with arduous training, will put you in a very good place to be successful. Finally, an absolutely crucial consideration while you are identifying how you will operate within your battlefield is, can you maintain it? Are you sure that routine is for you? If you are looking to train at 9 p.m. at night because of your work and family commitments, are you going to be okay to work at 7 the next morning? Can you see why I'm asking these questions? If you are getting up to train at 4 a.m. after being on a feeding shift with the baby from 0100 to 0330, then you may get it done once, but you've got to pay the piper. And then try keeping that up for 3 months. It just will not happen. The gold standard example of this is the New Year's resolution. New Year, new me, and all that good stuff. It wouldn't be shocking to hear that over 80% of New Year's resolutions are binned off by the second week of February. Most of that 80% don't even make it that far. Research conducted by Strava in 2019, using over 800 million user logged activities, predicted that the day most people are likely to give up on their New Year's resolution is January the 19th. Just 19 days into an aim, Strava called it Quitter's Day. I often find Quitter's Day comes much earlier, and the way I frequently catch people out on how much they really want something is by starting a training program on any other day but a Monday. Now you may be thinking, what sick human starts a training cycle or nutrition plan on a Thursday? Nobody starts a training program or nutrition plan on a Thursday or Friday. But why? Why do we always have to wait until Monday or the new year? At what stage do we stop repeatedly moving the start point, stop making excuses, stop dreaming, and start doing? What you do now, in the present, will shape what your future looks like. If that's a Thursday, then you are already increasing the gap from what you would have been on Monday. It doesn't matter how ridiculous and scarcely close to being unachievable your aim is. Stop dreaming and start doing. It's crazy how many people this puts off. but it's a great filter for me to determine who genuinely wants their aim. The day of the week we start training is irrelevant. It's just another day closer to success. We start today. We start right now. And we dictate how successful tomorrow is, and we control the outcome of the aim, regardless of how crazy or difficult that is. While it's harder to remain on track and achieve a large goal as opposed to a smaller one, the difficulty of the goal is irrelevant. Once it's set, achieving it isn't nearly as important as whether you develop the kind of habits that allow you to stay the course and at least attempt to be successful in that goal. Falling short isn't as bad as quitting. I can accept someone not quite being good enough after effort is applied. But giving up is different, and is not something I condone. I spoke a lot about winning earlier and didn't want to touch on losing until now. I will go into more detail on the ups and downs of development and depth more in Chapter 3. But at this stage, it's key to point out that nobody has ever won everything. Floyd Mayweather may never have lost a professional fight, the main statistic that we all remember. But to get there, he lost 8 amateur bouts, came up short on multiple training sessions, he lost rounds, he missed weight, and no doubt he lost friends and coaches throughout. How many missed putts and rounds of golf do you think one of the greatest ever golfers, Tiger Woods, has lost? This is collateral. It's inevitable. And in order for them to win so often, they had to learn what losing felt like. When you lose, you must learn. And I can assure you, you never want that feeling of losing again, and you double down to ensure it never happens. The ultimate point of question 2 is to get you considering whether your aim is achievable and sustainable by understanding the obstacles external to your ability that also stand in the way of success. Somebody with a clean slate, no commitments, and no time restraints are an easy win. But I've been in this game long enough to realise that very few people have this luxury. The closest I've come to someone almost having free rein on their life was training a prince for the commando course. And even then, his schedule was chaotic. It's still chaotic now. Just a little easier done with his green lid on and dagger on his arm. Just like the prince, and like every other athlete I work with, I need you to think about your environment so early on, because once we commit to an aim and we agree to do it together, I need you to be fully aware of the reality that you will be training in, and so that we can plan, sustain, and sidestep any obstacles and eradicate any excuses straight from the off. You might even realise that you don't want that goal after all, or it might just not be feasible right now and it's something you may have to hold out for. All of which is okay. It's better to learn that now than after spending weeks or months going for something that you actually don't want. Question 3. Are you still in? Some people want things to happen. Others even wish and pray they would happen. But some of us, and it's only a small percentage of us, actually get out there and make it happen. We find ways to win. Now, if you want to win, however big or small, or how indifferent your wins are, then I'm fully in with you. This is a deal, and it will not be the first automated, subconscious deal you have made in your life. You make these small arrangements all the time, especially when training. During every session, we make multiple deals, we cross multiple barriers, and present ourselves with multiple options. From a coach-athlete perspective, the coach provides the plan, and the athlete agrees to conduct the session and hit every distance, rep, and set within. This is a deal. The athlete then has multiple barriers throughout that session when they hit the wall or nearly fail the last rep, but were motivated enough to complete the set. The option is then whether the athlete feels they have enough time or energy to conduct the last set. Knowing they nearly failed the rep before, the easy option is to leave it. But that wasn't the deal. If you agree to it, then you get it done. So you've now considered what you want, and you've addressed the potential barriers you might face in getting there. The next question is, how do you overcome these obstacles when training gets a little difficult and the odds start stacking up against you? The easiest road to take is the easiest option. Its direction is simple. You do not continue. You therefore do not develop as an athlete, and you do not grow as a person. The only reward for this option is that it is easy. When you give up, even if it's something that is not very important, it becomes a habit, which will become a ritual, which will then allow you to give up during any situation. The excuse becomes a part of your arsenal and normal operating procedure. To counter the excuse, you must make continuous pacts and deals with yourself. I'll keep going until the next tree. I'll rest at the top. I can do one more round. We grow, Joe, in those last rounds and between the distance of the tree you thought you was going to stop at and the one you are now hunting down. This is where we overload and when we discourage the easy options. To do this, you must make these deals over and over again, throughout your session, throughout your program, and throughout your life. I will go into what I mean by overload and further into the psychology of always moving forward. But for now, I want to end how you look at question three with this. Each deal provides a choice, and each time you must make a promise that you'll keep going and you'll hold your end of the contract. One more rep, one more mile, one more time more than those who broke the contract and took the easy option. Conclusion. You'll probably notice at this stage I've talked about absolutely nothing physical. There is no point in asking about any of that yet. Zero point in starting a program if I know your battlefield is strewn with so many minds that you cannot do anything right now. I can only work with you if I know who you truly are, where you want to go, and that you are in to do everything it takes to get there. After all, a physical development program is just a series of cleverly placed words and numbers. Without the athlete buy-in and willingness to commit, even the greatest program on earth holds no depth and is ultimately pointless. This is an immediate taste of a central theme that runs throughout this audiobook. That is, me helping you to rethink about how you traditionally approach making changes in your life. Whether it's thinking about past fitness levels or jumping into a plan with both feet without first considering how manageable and sustainable it is, both for you and those who depend on you. We do this work now so that there are no surprises and, more importantly, no excuses later. It's one of the reasons I call my first business Red On Fitness, and why this audio original is titled The Red On Revolution. For airborne forces within the military, you are obviously required to parachute. Now, just before you leave the aircraft, a green light flashes and you must react on the words of command, go, and immediately leave the plane. Extremely simple. However, a lot has to happen prior to that one moment of execution. Prior to the green light, a red light comes on. And prior to the words of command go, the parachute jump instructor screams, red on. This is where you physically and mentally prepare to go. If you are not ready on red on, then you won't execute the words of command go. Everything I do in a coaching context has a huge element of preparation. I want to prepare you to react to everything and be ready for anything thrown at you at a moment's notice, time and time again. Consider the green light as the start point of your aim, however far into the future that is. If that's your first park run, then the klaxon to begin the race is your green light. If it's a cup final in a few months, then when that whistle blows, that's the jump instructor screaming go. I want you to have the ability to react when that happens. That's your green light. So this moment is your red light. This is your red on. And everything you do from here on out is to prepare you for that moment to ensure you are successful when the time comes. Not just for that one green light, but ready for anything, for every green light that you will face in the future. If you don't like your current position in life, then move, and move fast. You are not a fucking tree. You are you, and you can be incredible if you're honest with who you currently are and you put your effort into the right things with the right people around you. The absolute start of you being greater than you used to be is being brutally honest with your current self. At the end of this chapter, I want you to understand that who you are now is okay, because it's now, and will grow. For this to work, it's vital that we understand and appreciate your current battlefield, because everything and everyone within it will play a positive or negative role in your development and quite often be the driving factor in success. So if you're fully in, then I'm fully in too. Let's do this. I now want to add to the information from Chapter 1 by bringing in the first special guest appearance of this audio original. And what an athlete I have to begin with. He is none other than the UFC heavyweight fighter, Tom Aspinall. Tom has taken the heavyweight division by storm, most recently absolutely smashing the biggest fight of his career to date by defeating Alexander Volkov through a first round submission at the O2 Arena, and is currently ranked 6th in the division. He is one of the most powerful athletes I've ever coached. I have never seen anyone that big be so quick. I can't see any other direction than the top for him, becoming the UFC heavyweight champion, and I'm excited to be a part of that journey with him. Here I am, talking to Tom about some of the thinking I've detailed in Chapter 1. Good morning, Tom. How are you, mate?
I'm doing well, thanks, Mike. How's it going?
I'm very, very well, thank you, mate. I appreciate you're a busy man, so I'm just going to bounce straight into it, mate. I talk in the first chapter about why people do the things they do, about finding your why in order to start something. So what is your why, Tom? And what is it that you want most?
What I want most is, like, I want to be the UFC heavyweight champion of the world. That's, like, first and foremost for me. But kind of, like, behind that is, like, I want to, I don't know, maybe it's in front of that, to be honest, but I want to, like, provide a good life for me and my family. Like, that is my reason for doing this, really. But I guess the why, the reason that I started it is just because, and not the reason I started it, but the reason I carried on with it is just because I just found it, like, very natural. And I feel like there's not many things, like, in this world that like I love to do, and this is something that I like. MMA is something that I really, really love to do. So I guess that's the reason why I do it, is because I enjoy it, really.
Do you think that's important then for people with these? Because that's a pretty big ask, isn't it? What you've just said there, to be the heavyweight champion of the world, it's a big ask, isn't it? So do you think you have to love it? You have to love something to get to that level?
In my opinion, yeah. Like, it's always going to be forced, isn't it? Like, if you don't love something and you have to force yourself to go and do it every day, it's going to be hard to keep that motivation up. Whereas I actually love the process of, like, training, competing, fighting, and doing all the rest. Like, I absolutely love it. So for me, it's very easy. Like, it's obviously, some days are worse than others. Some day I'm bashed up, I'm tired, I don't feel like doing it that particular day. But overall, like, this is what I really, really want to do in my life. Like, this is my dream that I'm doing. So I enjoy it, and I feel like I wake up motivated to do it every day. And I think without that, it would be pretty difficult, in my opinion, anyway.
Yeah, 100%, mate. And that can be said, I feel, anyway, from an elite athlete perspective as yourself, from a coach perspective of myself. You know, and we've spoke about this so many times before. All we both want in life is to win. It's all we want. But do you think that can cross over? That sort of mindset can be crossed over to, like, the business world or to anything?
Oh, 100%. Like, if I wasn't doing this and I was doing something else, like, I would be successful at that as well, because I just have that mindset. Like, say, I'm just will do anything that I can to have any edge on any competition. Like, that's just what I'll do, is I'll go to the extreme in any circumstance to make sure that I win. And that transfers to anything in life, really, not just in, like I say, not in sport, in business, in jobs, in anything it transfers to, I think.
Yeah, and having that big goal is always great. That competition that we speak about right at the end. But there's 100,000, millions of little small wins, isn't there, every single day that you must do in order to get to that end product, isn't there?
Yeah, definitely. I have a thing personally where if I don't feel like doing it, I actually make sure that I still do it. Like, say I didn't feel like going for a run, for example, I would make sure that I ran further than I would if I felt like it, if that makes any sense. Because I think once you start, like, there's a lot of people who train one way and they think that they're going to fight or compete a different way to what they train. So if they're used to quitting in training, or they're used to not doing something in training, and then they think that they're going to be able to pull it off in a competition, like, that, they're completely wrong. Like, you need to get used to, like, doing stuff that you don't want to do every day to be able to do it when it's important. Do you know what I mean?
1,000%, mate. It's something that I talk about in the book, where I discuss what's known as the deal. And it's all these small deals and these packs that you make with yourself. And, mate, I've been there before, where I've been looking ahead of down the road on a run and thinking, do you know what? Sack this. It'd be so easy for me to just stop. And it is. It would be the easiest thing to stop. But that's the difference, isn't it? You've said, I want to be the heavyweight champion of the world. Now, you've got to make a serious amount of small deals and small wins to go and achieve that.
Oh, definitely. And like we just touched on a minute ago, like, if you're on that run and you think, oh, I can't be arsed, I'm just going to stop, I'm just going to walk, or I'm just going to leave it there for today. When the fight gets tough and you've said that to yourself 10 times in the build up to the fight, oh, I'm just going to leave it today. Like that mental aspect, like that carries over, and a lot of people don't, they've not really tapped into that, I feel. Like a lot of different people competing in different sports, they've not really tapped into these little deals like you're talking about, where these deals, they pay off in competition, and people don't really I find a lot of athletes don't realize that. Like if you start backing out on these deals on a regular basis, you're going to back out on these deals when it matters on the big stage in competition. So you have to make sure that you stick to these little deals and these little promises that you have to yourself, no matter what you feel like. Like just this morning, for example, like as you know, Mike, I've got 2-year-old twins at the moment, mate. They've got chicken pox, so I've had an hour's sleep, and right now I'm outside the tattoo shop. I've got to get tattooed now for 8 hours, and I didn't want to get up and work out this morning. Like I'm doing everything that I can in my mind to not go and do the workout that you've given me this morning, but mate, I went and did the workout and I feel better for it because I know that not only physically but mentally I've done that workout, and like you say, I've kept that deal with myself that when the fight gets tough, when something doesn't go my way, when something doesn't go my way on fight day or in the fight or whatever, like I've pushed through it when it's difficult. So like that's a box ticked in my mind, and I think more athletes and more even people like in the business world, like you say, or other stuff, like they need to start tapping into that as well.
Yeah, I couldn't agree anymore, mate. And your mindset is pretty sound. You're pretty set on what you want in life. And then you spoke a little bit there about the training and the physical side of life. How important is that in your role, being as physically robust and as physically strong as you possibly can?
Well, my sport's extremely physical, so if I'm not in the best physical shape, like I'm not gonna succeed. You have to have a little bit of everything in my sport. Like you need to be technical, you need to be physical, and you need to have a very good mental game as well. So you need to be like very well rounded in all aspects of being an athlete, really. So yeah, like obviously working with you and stuff, like I'm striving to be the best athlete that I can possibly be. That's my goal, is to never be satisfied and just be chasing being the best athlete that I can possibly be in all aspects.
Yeah, and in terms of, so is there anything, not just in particular working with me, mate, I'm thinking in as the whole picture and in a physical sense only, as you've got further and further up the ranks, what's changed for you in terms of how you look at the physicality of your work?
I think I definitely look better than I used to. Definitely, because I used to be like out of shape and stuff, and now I'm in much better shape. And I think just the speed that I move is way different than most of the heavyweights. Like I think that's for like the naked eye to see, the untrained eye. Like I think you can just see straight away, even if you don't know anything about the sport, that I move in a different speed to the rest of the heavyweight division. But not only that, is I think since working with you and stuff, and it maybe even before working with you, like I think that I'm very physically strong anyway, and I think that because I'm not a massive muscular guy, a lot of people kind of look past that. But I think I have some muscle on my body, don't get me wrong, but I'm not like a bodybuilder type looking guy. But I think I'm very physically strong, and not a lot of people take that into account.
Yeah, and I know full well about that with some of the test results we've done and some of the testing batteries we've gone through. Is there anything that you do then that would surprise people? Big heavyweight fighting in, the best of the organization in the world, the most arduous in terms of MMA. Is there anything that people would be very surprised to hear about what you do from in that would almost be considered, weak or unknown from someone in that sort of in that area of work?
In terms of what? In terms of training?
Yeah, in terms of training, so people seem to think that to get extremely strong, it's you go and lift the heaviest amounts of weight the most amount of times, and obviously I'd like to think that when we've started working with each other, I've tried to change that little bit, and it's the small things that we do that no one else is doing, and that's when you're doing the.
I mean, I think a lot of people they think that you have to do like chest and bicep and all that kind of stuff to get stronger for this. Like for this, I can only speak on MMA really because that's my sport. But yeah, they're completely wrong. They're completely wrong. Like obviously, we work a lot of stuff like with the stuff like hamstring stuff, a lot of core, a lot of like explosive stuff with the feet and ankle mobility and all, like. People think that to be strong, you have to have like a big chest and arms and stuff, and that is just not the case in my sport. Like, if you've got a strong core and strong legs, like usually that is what sets you apart. But definitely, like the core stability and the explosive movements is something that's massive in my sport, I think.
Yeah, and it's massive in every single sport, not just MMA. The crossover between every sport is incredible, but nobody does it, which is it's outrageous when you think about it. And one last thing that I'd like to talk to you very much about is before we end, actually, I want to talk to you about the toughest non-physical thing that you encounter as a fighter. So I think we touched on it a little bit earlier, but I just want to touch a little bit more on the non-physical side of life and what's the toughest non-physical things that you encounter as a fighter?
Oh, that's a good question. There's quite a lot, to be honest. There's quite a lot. Just right off the bat, like for me, like the mental side of actually being an everyday guy and then having to go and fight in front of 20,000 people and then going back to being an everyday guy the day after, like that's quite difficult for me. It's just a weird kind of, I don't know, it's just weird, mate, to be stood there at the school gate on a Monday morning, less than 48 hours after winning a massive main event at the O2 in London. Like stuff like that is very odd. Do you know what I mean? It's difficult to like get your head around stuff like that, I think. But that's only like at the top level you experience stuff like that. But yeah, just the mental side of fighting is difficult. You know what I mean? It's easy to watch two guys on TV and be like, oh, we should have done this, should have done that. But it's so difficult when you're in there to pull any of that stuff off. The mental side of it is so difficult.
Oh man, I mean, from my point of view, I mean, my normal strength conditioning coaching is to do with the majority of the people who want to go on special forces selection. And what I normally do is we do an S&C plan. They go away, complete it. I get a text message in 6 months' time going, I'm in. But to live and breathe that moment when you was working in, when you went to work in the O2 and being in that arena at the same time, and I'm outside of the octagon. So never mind, I'm getting punched in the face by, some 7 foot Russian. I felt that, mate. So what you must feel, and then to try and come back down to earth straight after that, and that is pretty difficult, isn't it?
It is, and that's something that I'm only really now experiencing. Do you know what I mean? When you're fighting on lower level shows, it's still quite extreme, to be honest. Because even though you might be fighting in front of 100 people, it's still a massive deal in your own mind. Do you know what I mean? It doesn't matter if there's 100 people or 100,000 people. To you, it's the most important thing in the world. So, like I say, to be just living normal the day, it's just a very odd experience, and I don't think. You can't really account for that when you're training. Do you know what I mean? You can't account for it. It's something that only comes like really with experience. So I am now at this point getting more experience. I do know what to expect, and yeah, it's strange. I think, like you say, when you see it firsthand, and it's someone you actually know and care for, and have worked with, to see them live do it, you kind of really do get a feel for how big of an occasion it is for everybody, and that's not just headlining UFC shows, you know what I mean? That's right down to amateur level. Like it's a massive deal to put your body and your spirit and your mind on the line in front of a lot of people. Like it's a big deal in any aspect.
Does it make you want more?
Oh mate, I love it. Like this is what I live for. You know what I mean? Like this is I truly believe that this is what I'm on this earth for, is to do this sport because it comes really natural to me, and there's nothing that can ever replace that, mate, in your life. Like I've got this now for the next hopefully 10 years, and there's nothing that can ever come close to that for me. Like that night, mate, in London a few weeks ago. And there's going to be other nights in London. There's going to be title fights, but nothing will ever be as big as that for me. It's headlining my first ever show in London. Like that's as big as it'll ever get for me.
Tom, I just want to say thank you so much for taking the time to come and chat with us. It's been an absolute pleasure, mate, and I'm so excited to see how far you can go in this division.
Oh, thanks, mate. Thanks for everything as well. I appreciate it. I don't tell you enough, but everything's going great, and thanks a lot for it.
I hope you enjoyed listening to Tom there. Keep an eye out for that man. He is destined for very big things. Now it's time for the first tactical takeaway to accompany Chapter 1. Tactical Takeaway 1. Before you proceed to Chapter 2, it would be most beneficial for you to follow 5 steps. 1. Think about and commit to paper an honest appraisal of your current ability and level. 2. Write down your answer to that question I asked. If you had a clean slate, what is it that you want to achieve? 3. Write down what is currently going to stop you, so that you can see how to work around it. For this, I have included a battlefield brainstorm in the Tactical Takeaways PDF that you can download along with this audio original. 4. Talk to those closest to you about what you plan to do. See how you can get them on board to make it viable and sustainable. You can even share with them your answers to step 3, as they themselves may possibly add input and suggestions as to how to make it work. 5. After following all the 4 steps above, answer one simple, final question. Are you still in? Chapter 2, What We Need. You will notice how, from now on, the subject of our chapter headings will change, from you to we. This is because we are now a team. And so let's begin Chapter 2, which will cover what we need. What we vitally need in all walks of life is availability. And in order to be available, we need to possess a foundation of strength. This is because our greatest ability is, in fact, availability. You cannot grow as a person if you cannot train, and you cannot train if you are not available to train. Hopefully, by thinking about and answering the questions posed in Chapter 1, we have already worked out that you are mentally available to train, in terms of managing it alongside your life demands, and as well as having the support of those people around you psychosocially. And this mental availability will not simply mean you being energized and committed for 2 weeks, or just a month, but going forward sustainably and being ready to work hard for long periods of time. There is no point in being a superstar for a course, a game, or a year or two. Sustainable success is what makes champions, and we will now learn how to maintain being a champion. I now need to ensure, and this is the central focus of Chapter 2, that you're physically available, and this is where your foundation comes in. The foundation. As with elsewhere, I want you to question your thinking at this point. As I am pretty sure that now you have made this deal and prepared yourself to begin, your first and foremost instinct is going to be smash it. Right then, 100 miles per hour, let's go. I'm all in. Where do you want me? I want you to stop right there. I know you're fully in because we made the deal to be in together earlier. But we cannot go from nothing to all in, even if you have the best psychology or the best psychosocial support. David Goggins is a former Navy SEAL and is often referred to as the toughest man on the planet. He often talks about the mind and how it provides him the ability to keep going. This is true at his level, but his level has been earned by working extremely hard on his physical preparedness over a prolonged period of time. Firstly, in his military career, and secondly, in his ultra running, cycling and triathlon training. You don't just wake up and complete Special Forces selection in the hope your winning mindset will pull you through the hills phase, consisting of multiple loaded marches against the clock, over arduous terrain, all because you've agreed that you were fully in to compete. You will not get through the first event of a triathlon through grit and mental toughness if you cannot swim. You pass events like these by firstly preparing physically, secondly surrounding yourself with like-minded people to improve yourself psychosocially, and only later intervening when it gets tough, psychologically. It's a holistic approach at every step of the journey, and I'll dive in and out of these domains to show that together they are the ingredients that make up the rounded methodology for success. That methodology for success all begins with a foundation of strength. To understand the importance of this foundation, I want you to think of a pyramid. A pyramid starts off by being very broad and large at the bottom, and as it gets taller, it becomes narrower and more specific until it comes to the pointy end. That pointy end is what I call your competition. I define the term competition as your end goal. Your foundation of strength is the base of your pyramid. The foundation has to be superior to hold the pyramid up and keep it structurally sound. The taller the pyramid, or the more complex the aim, the bigger the base needs to be. Else you will limit your performance and increase the risk of injury, and your structure will become vulnerable. Therefore, we are not concerned with competition and performance at this point. We are only concerned with stability, sustainability, and your availability. I now want to suggest another analogy, and it's that of a house. A house cannot be built without first being given a foundation. You wouldn't consider buying one if the seller told you it didn't have a great foundation. And therefore, before you buy a house, you undertake a structural review to check that the foundations of that building are sound and strong. The same applies for training, with no better example being a professional footballer. When you think of a professional football club making a new signing in the summer transfer window, the image of the player's medical comes to mind. As, like with the house buying, all clubs need to first undertake a medical test for every new player they purchase. This is effectively a structural review of the athlete's body, an appraisal of their foundation. The only question those doctors are asking, just like the surveyors ask in relation to a house, is along the lines of, is this structure going to break down? They are looking for weaknesses in the athlete's body. They are solely focusing on the foundation at this stage. Anything else, like performance, they know they can work with. But they won't proceed if the foundation is broken. I want you to train so that you wouldn't fail the equivalent of that review upon your body, and so you can build on this foundation all the way to your unique competition. A foundation of strength is the most simplest, but it is also the most vital and often the most neglected part of our training. It can be broken down into three separate components: bomb-proof core, prehabilitation, and strength and depth. These should be seen as three objectives, rather than three incremental stages, as they are built simultaneously rather than in a sequence. Bomb-proof core. Firstly, I want you to consider where exactly you think your core is. It might come as a surprise to you when you hear me say that I don't consider the core to be exclusively the abdominals. Instead, I consider pretty much everything between your nipples to your glutes. So anything centrally attached to the hips and shoulders and those muscles that are in and around our spine are the core. It is comprised of the abdominal muscles in both the front and side, the erector muscles, which handrail either side of your spine, the larger muscles that span multiple joints, such as your lats, which are the large V-shaped muscles that connect your arms to your vertebral column, as well as, most surprisingly, your glutes. Each and every one of these muscles must work in unison in order to enhance the stability of the spine during movements of the arms and legs. Therefore, it's key to point out that if the core spans an area much greater than solely the abs, then only conducting sit-ups every day may not be the answer to core strength and stability. I also want to explain early why the core is important, and in particular the importance of core stability, not only for performance, but for everyday life. The significance of its function goes further than protection of the spine, and it is vital for stabilization and force generation in all activities. This is because our everyday function is most often produced by what's known as the kinetic chain. This can be described anatomically as the interrelated groups of body segments, connecting joints and muscles working together to perform movements. In simple terms, the kinetic chain is the notion that joints and segments have an effect on one another during movement. When you are in motion, you create a chain of events that affects the movements of your neighbouring joints and segments. Everything inside of you is connected, and therefore any type of movement affects everything to a degree. Now consider all movements for a second. Whether you move your arms to place something high on a shelf, or your legs to walk up the stairs, it's all attached to the central part of your body. the core. Those legs and arms are what's known as the distal, away from the centre, segments of your body. The core is the proximal, nearer to the centre, segments of your body. Therefore, everything that is attached to the core requires localised strength and stability at the core. This ensures the distal segments, for example the legs, are put in the optimal position at the correct velocity at the right time to produce the desired task, such as taking each step to get up the stairs. Proximal stability is needed for distal movement, and the core is that proximal base for motion of the distal segments. In order for our limbs to move efficiently, we need to ensure we have stability and stiffness in the core. Core stability is pivotal for efficiency, maximizing force generation and minimizing joint loads in all types of activities, ranging from that climb up the stairs I mentioned, to sprinting down them and jumping off the bottom step, from standing up to throwing something. Failure to transfer forces efficiently through a stable core will result in suboptimal performance and will increase risk of injury. What the current problem is. The current problem surrounding how we approach and train the core, and the metrics by which we judge a strong core, is a society-wide lack of education, which the boot has nowadays probably been made even worse by social media bias. This, again, is the common misconception that the visual state of your abs is a reflection of the state of your core. We have all seen influencers on social media showing a 6-second clip of them conducting crunches, followed by a visual tour of their 8-pack, all to the sound of a trending TikTok song. Firstly, it's misleading, as incredible abs are not solely from sit-ups or any kind of dynamic abs exercise. An incredible amount of outrageous abs comes from the strictest of nutrition plans and an awful lot of sacrifice. There aren't many happy people with six-packs. A sit-up is the most common method to address a weak core. It's the go-to for most across the world to improve core strength and get abs. Now, dynamic strengthening exercises such as sit-ups, crunches, and Russian twists may be a good method for building core strength, if prescribed correctly, but they do very little improving core stability, or better termed, core stiffness. A good-looking set of abs does not necessarily mean strong, and it doesn't mean that person has a good core. This is a really detrimental misconception in society. If you put Mr. Olympia with the most clear-cut and perfect abs on P Company, he will die. Anything that goes left or right of what he does, and it's going to be horrendous. It would be a disaster for him. In reality, good core strength and stability is your ability to withstand the rigours and demands of your battlefield, whether that's to take a tackle in rugby and continue to progress up the pitch, or still be efficient and in control of your body running downhill whilst carrying a weapon system and external load on your back. Away from sporting and tactical contexts, the need is incredibly great in everyday life. Core strength and stability is paramount to picking your baby up out of the car seat, or being able to sit up straight at work for a prolonged period of time. 90% of people in desk jobs have shit lower backs because they have poor core strength, and I'm afraid that no amount of sit-ups will help to make that better. Sitting at a desk all day makes your hip flexors tight. A sit-up actually tightens your hip flexors more, and will therefore leave them worse off rather than better. So your generic, poorly prescribed workout that you got from a demigod-looking influencer will actually be making things worse. The same misunderstanding was also prevalent in the military. The previous British Army test of soldiers' fitness not so long ago, and as close as 2019, was a 2-minute best effort of press-ups and sit-ups, followed by a timed test of a 1.5-mile run. What no one had realised until a study found it to be the case is that tightening those hip flexors through sit-ups prior to going for a run led to an increased chance of injury and a reduction in running performance, therefore devaluing the running test. The 1.5 mile was supposed to test aerobic capacity, but in a lab environment, tightening the hip flexors prior would reduce validity and reliability of testing aerobic capacity. This old and wrong way was how they would evaluate a soldier's fitness, and this had been going on for 20 years by the time that I was a physical training instructor in the army. I found it crazy. The more I began to learn about the body, the more I would pick the physical test apart. I was lucky enough to be in the rooms where we would rip this apart and concentrate on doing something of more value to better identify a soldier's fitness. Now we've heard what the problem is, we need the solution. So if sit-ups, which contract the core muscles, aren't the best way to train your core, then I'll tell you what is. And here comes another piece of counterintuitive information. To train the core, we are not looking for contraction, but for resisting contraction. Rather than move, I want you to resist movement. Now I'll go on to explain how unique you are later on in this audiobook, and how there is unfortunately no one-size-fits-all when it comes to training. The same applies for core exercises. Because there is no single universal movement that equally stresses all of the muscles that surround your spine. For this reason, we should utilize multiple exercises to efficiently work all of them. There are three specific exercises that most efficiently address all of these muscles around your spine without placing excessive pressure and stress on your back, the common area that flags up you having a core deficiency. This group of exercises has famously become known as the Big Three, created by Professor Stuart McGill. In every single program I have built in and out of the military, this element of preparation has been at the forefront of all of my thinking. It's non-negotiable. The McGill Big Three is made up of three simple exercises, consisting of a thoracic curl-up, probably the least known of the three exercises, which focuses on stabilizing the front-facing core muscles, the side plank, which places emphasis on stabilizing the side core muscles, and the bird dog, which promotes a stable core while movement occurs at the surrounding joints. You'll notice that there is literally no movement in the core with any of these exercises. This is because the Big Three concentrates wholeheartedly on resisting movement, which brings us back to the famous and trusted sit-up, for which, when you conduct the movement, you contract the muscles to move. What we want to do is the opposite, and therefore to resist movement. Take, for instance, the bird dog exercise. During the bird dog, the combination of movement happening at the hips and shoulders as you extend your left arm and right leg, for example, requires the lower back to remain completely fixed in place and stable. The core here is the proximal stiffness, which allows the arms and legs to safely be the distal movement. What we are working on here is anti-rotation. The core is working overtime to ensure we don't rotate and remain completely still, with our back flat, perpendicular to the floor. Anti-rotational exercises, like the bird dog, are exercises that build stability and strength to prevent rotation in everyday life. These specific exercises ensure our bodies are able to resist forces acting upon them. Forces that may try to rotate or move it in a way and direction that's deemed unsafe. If you are hit whilst playing rugby, climb a rope with more weight on one side, or you simply slip on ice, anti-rotational exercises help our bodies remain strong so that our core can handle the torque. This makes us more efficient and ensures unsafe movements don't lead to poor movement mechanics, which translates to quicker energy loss, then pain, and then injury. This particular exercise is done last of the three, as it has perfect carryover to the movements you will go on to perform in your session and throughout your day.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.